My idea of success is to be able to make a decent living doing the thing you've always wanted to do.
Welcome to Successful Living with Bill Knapik. Every week we talk about success and everything that goes along with it. You'll learn the principles of success, how to achieve success, and learn to overcome challenges that may be getting in the way of success in your life. You'll hear from Bill Knapik, a radio personality and business development expert, along with insight from special guests. If you're ready to find your path to success or take the success you're enjoying to the next level, stay tuned. Successful Living with Bill Knapik is on right now.
And welcome to the show, Successful Living with Bill Knapik. And today, Successful Living with the one and only very, very successful best-selling author. His name is Stuart Woods. I'm sure you've read one or, like me, almost all of his books. Mr. Woods, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much, Bill.
First of all, your current book, Indecent Exposure, I am reading it right now. Let's tell people about your latest Stone Barrington novel.
All right. Well, I'm not going to tell them very much because I want them to find out what it's about by reading it. Every time I get a new editor, I have to train him or her not to blow the plot in the cover notes.
Exactly.
And I feel that way about telling people what the book is about. It's a Stone Barrington novel, and that's really all they need to know until they've read a few pages.
And that's right. And when we talk about reading the pages of a Stone Barrington novel or any of your other ones, they go by so quickly. That, to me, that's one of the great things. And I've said it before, other than the plot is always great. Stone leads an unbelievable life. But the way you describe whatever he does or the characters do, that in itself is totally engaging.
Well, thank you.
And in particular, I'm going to mention a book that goes way back, The Short Forever. And I recall a scene as far as whatever he was doing in it. But the thing I enjoyed about The Short Forever, one of the things was that when he was between the action, let's say, he went shopping in London. And just the way you paint the picture of his shopping afternoon was just incredible. How do you do it, Stuart?
Well, I go shopping. If I'm in London, I invariably go shopping. So I just take him on one of my shopping trips.
This makes me think of the thing about all the characters, including Stone, and that is they seem so real to the readers. And I've heard you talk about the characters. They seem and are so real to you. Tell us about that.
They are. In fact, I live their lives. It's not just Stone, but all of them. And so I know them pretty well, and I know how they think and how they talk. And I think after a while, the reader does too.
And that's right. The reader, as like myself, we come to expect things, but also along the way, even people like Teddy Fay, we like to be surprised, and you provide that as well.
Yes, Teddy is full of surprises. No one ever knows what Teddy's going to do next.
Teddy has a skill set that I wish I just had a third of. Of course, I could say that about Stone as well. But let's tell people, you mentioned that as far as, and I was thinking about this when I was coming to the station today, and you have some similarities. You fly a plane like Stone does. You lead an exciting life. You like good food. You have several homes all over the United States. So where does Stuart Woods end and Stone begin, or vice versa?
Well, I think right about that point, Stone is taller, better looking, and luckier than I am. But that's our main difference. I think, in fact, I'm probably more like Will Lee than I am any of the other characters.
And Holly Barker, in this new book, I won't give anything away, but there's a section. She has come such a long way since, I believe, the first book she was in. Was it Orchid Beach?
Yep.
Well, she has come a long way in her career, in her rich life. But it was interesting, without ruining it for people, I just read the section yesterday where Stone ends up giving her some tremendous legal counsel in a expanded way, and I thought, wow, what a great addition to the relationship between Stone and Holly.
Well, she's got a top job right now, which I won't discuss because I'd rather the reader learned about it by reading, and she has some interesting times ahead of her.
Well, that's right, and she is a fascinating character. You may be asked this all the time, but when we think of it, well, let's ask about your vision. When you think of Holly, if you were to maybe name an actress or two that you have in mind, if there is such, when you think of Holly and write about Holly, who would that be?
You know, I don't really think of Holly in terms of an actress. I think a lot of actors could play her. She's a fairly big girl. She's 5'8 or 5'9, and she's not skinny, and she's able to take care of herself in a physical sense. So she's not wispy or flighty. She's a rock-solid kind of person who does a good job of taking care of herself.
She really does, and she has a delightful personality. Stone really gets along, I would say even loves her so much. They have a great relationship through all the books. That's tremendous.
It's a good thing that they don't live in the same city, or I wouldn't have anything to write about.
Well, that's right. The entering and exiting the picture is always fascinating. And we are talking with Stuart Woods about his new book, Indecent Exposure. Going back to the idea of actors and actresses, what about Stone? Who do you see there, if you see anybody at all?
Well, again, I try not to think of people who might play Stone. If I had begun thinking that way, they would all be too old to play Stone by now. Actors have a way of aging, whereas Stone doesn't. Stone is in his early 40s, so is Dino, and they're going to stay there because that's my hedge against old age.
And that's a great thing. Now, I'm going to go to some of your similarities where you and Stone, you fly, and I'm going to guess you also drink Knob Creek?
Those are two things we share.
When you fly, as an author, as Stuart Woods, that is, when you're flying, Stuart, I would think that is a moment, because a lot of people look for inspiration when they drive, but it has to be fascinating to be in the sky on a jet. Tell us about the fuel for inspiration when you fly.
When you're at altitude and you're on course and you've got a tailwind maybe, then your mind is free to roam. Once in a while, you'll get a call from air traffic control, handing you off to the next controller, usually. Once in a while, something may go a little wrong that you have to deal with. I just saw something in the paper this morning where two pilots managed to put down a jet airplane in Buffalo, dead stick, with no engines, with a famous actress aboard. And that was quite a feat. Jets don't glide quite the way lighter airplanes do.
The other thing that I notice, and I think people identify with so many things in the characters, but also they identify with things that they'd like to do that the characters get to do. But one thing that is not for everybody, but many, many people love pets. And you've incorporated, going back to Holly, at the very beginning in Orchid Beach, she had a dog named Daisy, right?
That's right.
And now you've, in the last few books, you brought in Stone's dog, which is Bob.
Right. He's a Labrador Retriever, and that's something else that Stone and I share. My dog's name is Fred.
Oh, that's right.
But Bob was a gift from a friend, one that he wasn't expecting and probably would have declined if he'd had an opportunity. But now he and Bob get along very well.
Having the dog in the picture in the books is great, but also in our own lives. I have two dogs. I only wanted one, but that's another story. With your dog, Fred, does he provide inspiration? Does he keep you company when you ride? Or what does
Fred
do? He
provides a lot of entertainment. Labrador Retrievers are puppies their whole lives, and he's almost 12 years old now, but he's still a puppy in his heart. And he amuses us no end. I let him in from being outside the other day, and to my astonishment, he did four very fast laps around the dining room table, running flat out. And I didn't even know he could still run.
Well, that's good news.
It's surprising.
And does he fly aboard your Citation?
He does. He's good crew. Mostly he goes to sleep. When he hears the landing gear go down, then he looks around to see where we are. The rest of the time, he's just stretched out, snoring away.
Interesting. I'm thinking of my own car. My dogs like to ride along with me, and when they're not in the car, somehow I notice their nose prints on the windows. I'm imagining your Citation has a few nose prints.
Well, he doesn't look out the windows much. I mean, once we're off the ground, he doesn't sit on the seat. He likes to lie in the aisle. But then when he hears the landing gear come down, then he knows that we're going to be landing very shortly after that, and he becomes a bit more alert.
Well, Stuart, your first novel, Chiefs, going back to 1981, did you ever imagine, we think about success and doing things that we love in our lives, do you ever pinch yourself?
all the time. It astonishes me. I mean, you talk about success. My idea of success is to be able to make a decent living doing the thing you've always wanted to do. It seems to me that a lot of people get tired of their careers about halfway through and wish they could do something else, and that seems to be especially true of lawyers. I've never gotten tired of this. It's what I wanted for myself.
And we're talking with Stuart Woods. His new book is Indecent Exposure.
And the first book, Chiefs, if I remember, took you quite a while to write.
It took me 8 years.
Oh, my goodness.
That's called writer's block, and that was a monumental case. I was looking for things to do instead of writing, like sailing. But eventually I signed a contract for a $7,500 advance, and that meant that I had promised somebody to deliver, so I delivered.
And all these years later, and now your schedule is two or three books a year?
Four.
Four, wow.
And I've been doing one with a co-author, and we're probably going to do a second with a co-author. My publisher wants to publish me every other month. So if we have six a year out, then he can publish me every other month.
Now, I noticed something on your website that I think I've never seen before. I love it, and I've printed it out. You have a downloadable list of all your books where we can look at the books and reminisce on the ones we've read and put a check mark by them, so that way we could keep up with you with all the stories, the Will Lee, the Stone Barrington, Holly, Ed Eagle, all those. But that
and
is
you
just
can take that list to the bookstore and fill in the gaps.
Just fill in and just bring your shopping basket and buy all the
right.
books. That's a great idea. Now, going back a few books, before I read Below the Belt, I read Sex, Lies, and Serious Money. The interesting thing about that, without giving anything away, one of the things I think as a reader with Stone and the characters, I think about, hey, it'd be nice to have that kind of freedom and that kind of financial freedom, because Stone has all the money he wants, but he's a good steward of it, and he's having fun with it. But in Sex, Lies, and Serious Money, I've never seen a character when that guy came to Stone and he started buying all that stuff. I would like to see the tab on the character. In,
yeah, I think that's what people do who win the lottery.
Exactly.
You know, and you see stories all the time about somebody who won some enormous amount of money 5 years ago, and they're suddenly penniless.
Oh, yeah.
And it's just astonishing how they can blow through huge amounts of money. I think a lot of it is due to friends and relatives who become very demanding when they discover that they have a rich relative or a rich friend. And I think that they succumb to giving too much of it away, buying a lot of things they don't really need or want.
Exactly. And that happens. But he really spent a lot of money, and I don't know where you get all the ideas. And then the one where he was Stone bought the home. I mean, they're buying homes without even seeing them. And so it's like, okay, I want to move in tomorrow. And then he does.
Right.
So maybe not be the best real estate advice, but it sure is fun to read what these people are doing in the books. And now you have, like, what, three homes now, Stuart?
Yes. Had three for a long time. They've changed over the years. Now they're in Key West, which is my legal address, Santa Fe, and then Mount Desert Island in Maine, which is where I am right now.
Oh, Maine is so beautiful. I have not been there for so many years, but I heard that there's more writers per capita in Maine. I don't know if that's true or not.
Or what?
More authors in Maine than...
I've never heard that before, but I couldn't blame them. I like being here myself. In fact, summer just arrived today. It's the first day it's been both warm and sunny since we've been here.
And when you say warm, what do you call warm?
It's actually 80 degrees, which is a scorcher in Maine. Normally, a midsummer day is mid-70s.
Well, I like that Stone and Dino are going to stay in their 40s. That is encouraging for me, and like you, and also the readers there. And also, it's exciting to see that you're writing so many books and plan to continue these characters. And, I mean, you've already said it, but in a way, you don't get tired of them, do you?
I don't.
You just keep on writing the stories. Now, as far as the last time we talked, I would like to repeat this, even if you've changed your writing discipline or schedule, but I thought it was very interesting that I believe you said you write every day for what, one chapter a day?
A chapter a day, that takes me 1 hour. So I work from 11 to 12 every day, and then I'm as free as a bird.
And then the beauty of that is that compiles, if you do it every day, next thing you know,
That's how I write 4 novels a year. You can't let go days go by without work. We took a fairly long vacation last month, and I only got about 3 days work done the whole time, but that's very unusual for me. And the day we got back, then I was back on schedule.
And thinking of geography, Maine, Key West, some of the activity with the characters also takes place, in fact, a lot of it does, in Southern California, one of my favorite places to visit.
Right.
And now, do you ever spend time there in Southern California researching Stone's adventures?
I used to spend more time there, but now I'm there every year for the L.A. Times Book Festival, which is one of my favorite events. They have about 150,000-175,000 visitors and about 400 authors to talk to them and sign their books. And it's just a great fun. I get to see some writers that I would not get to see otherwise. Bump into some old acquaintances, and that's always fun. I'm only there for 1 weekend a year, usually.
And give people an idea, in Florida, as you have your residence there, what is it you love about and Florida's like Houston, Texas, in some ways, without maybe as many palm trees, but what is it you love about the Florida geography?
Well, I'm not a big fan of Florida. I am a big fan of the Florida Keys, which is where I live. Key West doesn't really have much to do with Florida. It's more of a banana republic, and it's isolated and at the very southernmost tip of the continental United States. People don't go there accidentally because it's the end of the line, and it attracts a really interesting crowd of residents, a lot of writers over the years, though they seem to live there a few years and then move on to somewhere else. But it's a very lovely place to live in the winter.
And another thing that happens with great authors like yourself, or that I take away or like to take away, and that is along the way we learn new words when you write. For example, one of the words was the title of your book back in 1991, palindrome. I didn't know what palindrome was. In fact, going back many years, that might have been the reason I picked it up. I'm thinking, what's a palindrome? Well, we find out, and that goes way back to 1991.
Oh, palindrome is a word, a sentence, or sometimes even a line of poetry that's spelled exactly the same way backwards as forward. And I think the most famous one is the phrase, "Madam, I'm Adam."
Oh, okay. And also like Stone's dog, Bob.
Yes. That's palindromic.
Indeed it is. But also, that makes me want to, because I remember that book where there was, I believe, a football player, but I do want to revisit that book because I forget most of it except the word, and I'll have to go back and check that out.
Slightly crazed football player, as I recall.
That's right. And then the other thing that's coming to me, something about Georgia, but I could be wrong. We are talking to the great author, Stuart Woods. Go to stuartwoods.com and pick up his new book, Indecent Exposure. Well, Stuart, do you have, you've written so many books, bestsellers. I mean, I think it's over 40-some New York Times bestsellers. What's the number? Do you know?
Well, I think it's close to 55 I've written. This is my 68th novel. And the first one to make the list was number 15, so if you subtract, then you'll get the right number.
And you really are doing such important work. I can tell you that when I first found your books, I used to travel for about 30 years and with several companies, and so I was always on planes and hotel rooms. It was so important to have an interesting book. That's where I first learned about your books. I go back to the book Dead in the Water was always a great book. But that's where I first learned about you, and it really is important work. And do you ever think about the book that is going to live long after you and I are gone? These books, people will still be rediscovering Stone Barrington and Holly and Teddy and all the characters.
Well, I think I can't really die as long as somebody somewhere is reading a book of mine. There's a line from Shakespeare, it's the end of a sonnet. He says, "So long as men live and eyes see, so long lives this, and this gives life to thee." And that's a pretty good motto for an author, I think.
And that is so, so well put. Also, Stuart, what else would we have a few minutes left here in the show. What are some of the thoughts? What else would you like to share with people? Let's tell them the website, first of all.
Well, the website is stuartwoods.com. It's been there for a long time. It's updated from time to time. There's a biography. There's a list of all the books. There's an interview, which contains the questions that readers most often ask me. So I, in my author's note, I ask people to read the interview before asking me questions by email, because I get enough email that answering the same questions and over would be difficult, I think. So people are invited to read that interview.
StuartWoods.com. And also, Stuart, what else would you like people to know?
I'd like them to know that the new book is on sale right now at a bookstore near them. And if they don't have it in stock, knock something off a shelf.
It is Indecent Exposure. And also, your next book will be coming out, I think, October?
Yeah, there'll be one in August. That's a co-authored book, I think, and then another one in October this year.
StuartWoods.com. The checklist is phenomenal. You can make sure you get all the books, but the current one I'm enjoying so much, Indecent Exposure. And the beauty of your book, Stuart, I like going to a restaurant where the menu, you don't know what to order, because whatever you order, you're thinking, okay, when I come back next time, I'm going to get this book. I'm going to get the other. I'm going to get the next item. And I know you're a big fan of great food, too. Give us a word about, give us maybe your two favorite dinners that you would like to sit down and eat.
Oh, my goodness. One of them would be the kind of food my mother used to cook, the Southern cooking that I grew up on, which is very hard to come by in Maine and Santa Fe, and not even easy in Key West. So sometimes I can talk my wife into cooking something like that.
Stuart, thank you so much.
Thank you, Bill. I've enjoyed talking to you.
It means so much. And please give our best to Fred and your lovely wife. And do you ever get to Houston?
Yes, occasionally on a book tour. I might even be there in October. I haven't gotten a schedule yet, but... there's a very good mystery bookstore there that I usually go to.
I will be on the lookout for that, and we'll hope to have you on again prior to that book coming out and get to
Great.
Meet you right here in Houston. The website is StuartWoods.com. His current book is Indecent Exposure. And you have been listening to Successful Living with Bill Knapik. And today, one of the most successful authors right here in the USA, Stuart Woods. Tune in next week to Successful Living with Bill Knapik. And thank you so much for listening, and thank you again, Mr. Stuart Woods.
Thank you, Bill. Bye-bye.
How many times must I tell you, babe? How many bridges I've got to cross? How many times must I explain myself? Or I can talk to the boss. Or I can talk to the boss.
There's a line from Shakespeare, it's the end of a sonnet. He says, "So long as men live and eyes see, so long lives this, and this gives life to thee." And that's a pretty good motto for an author, I think.